Gannett Project Manager Introduction, Part 1 of 2. This tutorial provides a brief introduction to the Gannett Project Manager from the perspective of a developer working from within the Gannett Programming Studio, or GPS for short. The Gannett Project Manager uses the information in project files to connect the source code and other software artifacts to the GPS development environment, which integrates various tools into one place. For the purpose of this tutorial, let's assume that the objective is to use GPS to maintain an existing body of code, and that the code happens to be a library for processing XML data streams. What we initially receive are two deliverables, the documentation and the source code. Now, if all we wanted was to build a static or dynamic library, where there is no need to understand the code, we could create a simple project where the sources appear in one directory. However, because our task is to maintain the code, we need to understand it in order to efficiently make changes. Therefore, the sources must be organized into logical components. From the documentation and the file names, we see that the library consists of five components: DOM, input sources, SACS, Schema, and Unicode. The first step is to organize the files into a structure where each component has its own directory. Here we see the code associated with the input sources component. The documentation also shows that the XML library uses a layered architecture, where Schema depends on DOM, which depends on SACS, and so on. The abstraction layer at the bottom, Unicode, is by definition a standalone component, and therefore the target of our first Gannett project. Because of the dependencies, we need to work from the bottom upwards. So let's begin by starting the GPS application. Once GPS is loaded, the welcome dialog appears. Bear in mind that the information we provide in the following workflow is controlled and recorded by the Gannett Project Manager. At the end of this workflow, the project file is created. At this point, select Create New Project with Wizard and click OK. Since the sources represent a library and not an application, we select Library Project and click Forward. The first thing to notice is our position in the workflow, as indicated on the left side of the window. For the name of the project, I've appended underscore lib to the component name to identify it as a library. In the next field, we specify that the project file be created in the root of the Unicode directory. Click Forward to proceed. In the Languages dialog, Ada is automatically selected. If you wish to use another language to help maintaining the Ada code, such as Python for scripting purposes, then this window provides the opportunity to modify the project file for the specified languages. Click Forward. As expected, we find ourselves in a dialog with the Gannett Project Manager to specify details of the version control system. Supported version control systems are displayed in the drop-down list. Since this tutorial does not get into version control details, we simply click Forward to proceed. By default, the Gannett Project Manager assumes that the sources are in the same directory as the project file. In our case, however, this assumption is incorrect. The sources are actually in the SRC directory. No problem. We simply remove the wrong path and add the correct path. We can also use this dialog to specify other source directories relevant to the Unicode library to extend the capabilities of this component. Click Forward to proceed. Every Gannett project requires a build directory for the object files generated by the compiler. To keep things organized, we specify a subdirectory called build by clicking Browse, which opens the Browse for Folder window, and use the Make a New Folder button to create the build directory. Since this is a library project, there is no executable, and so we leave the second field as it is. Also, since the Ada doc has generated content, the build directory is a good place for the subdirectory doc, and so we accept this default. This is a library project, and therefore there are no main units. Click Forward. When the file is created, the library name will be prefixed with lib. Therefore, to make the resulting file name more readable, it is a good idea to use an underscore as the first character. Using the same procedure as for build, we specify a library directory called libr, which also serves to contain the LA files. Accept the remaining default values and click Forward. We will use the Gannett default naming scheme in this tutorial. Click Forward to proceed to the Switches dialog. The switches dialog allows us to configure the behavior of the builder, compiler, binder, linker, debugger, and pretty printer tools. Here we see switches associated with the builder. The field along the bottom is used to display the value of non-default switches. So for example, if we check keep going and debug, the field will show the corresponding values, minus G and minus K. Another useful feature is the tooltip information box to provide some details about each switch. Here we see switches associated with the compiler, the binder, the linker, and the pretty printer, which of course is another name for source code formatter. At this point, the workflow process is finished. We may now click Apply so that the GNAP Project Manager can create the GNAP Project file and load it into GPS. And here it is, the Unicode Library Project. Now is a good time to see if we can build a static library from the sources by running the build all command. And the answer is yes, the static library was indeed built as reported in the messages window. This is the end of part 1.